Hey everyone, and welcome back to Marksman Shooting Sports and SheepGunsUSA.com firearms gun store vlog. I am Chris, and today we're going to do more of, I've gotten a ton of interesting stuff in terms of inventory, so we are moving through the end of July, and August is just around the corner, actually starting tomorrow, so it's Tuesday, July 31st right now. We are now starting to bulk back up because the busy season for firearm sales will start to begin around the end of August, beginning of September. So we are getting in a whole bunch of stuff, getting ready for that. I've gotten some stuff in late last week and early this week that I want to show you. Now, also at the end of this, we do have a little bit of show and tell with Andy. And I do have the vlog question of the week, which is going to revolve around gun safety, especially when you're purchasing firearms and storing them at home, when you have little ones running around or other people that you are generally trying to keep the firearm secure from so that nobody gets hurt and that sort of thing. Responsibility, adulting, you know, that sort of thing. So anyway, without further ado, let's jump into it. Things that we love and that our customers in here really enjoy is the surplus stuff. And as I've said on previous vlogs, we've really gotten into a lot of the surplus type things. So I have gotten in a selection of the Tokarev M88As. These are in 9mm. Now, a lot of these that showed up came with the wooden grips on it, which is actually pretty uncommon. And they are in very good condition. All the ones we have are in excellent shape. So really happy to have those guys in. Another thing that we used to have a lot of that we sold out of, so I restocked, are these Star Model BMs. Now, anybody thinking about getting these, I actually purchased one myself and so did Andy. And essentially what you have here is a full steel frame, steel construction, nicely blued 1911 and 9mm for $200 to $250. That is a heck of a deal for what these are. And really, when it comes to surplus stuff, what I've seen over the years is, you know, the supply of these is definite. I mean, there is a limited number of these that exist. When they are brought into the country and sold, they are going to be gone. And when they're gone, these are not going to be $250. These are going to be $350, $400. Because again, keep in mind, these are still steel frame 1911s. If you go to the, you know, kind of the commercial market here in the United States, the cheapest you'll probably find are like Rock Island or Para Ordnance. And even for those used, you're going to pay around the $300 to $350 range. So really, 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 really good deal, really good value. So if you're looking at these, definitely jump on one. I mean, they're just totally cool and they work. Ours have worked great. So just a little bit of information there for you. Now, other surplus stuff. I just got in some surplus stuff now that I'm going to open up and show you. So these are probably currently some of the most highly collected or in demand surplus, at least handguns. They come from Bulgaria. Might give some of you guys a clue. But lately these have been really popular. And what we have are pretty much unissued condition Bulgarian Makarovs. Again, if you're looking into surplus firearms, these are the types of things that are going to go up crazy high in value. In fact, they already are. Even though they are still coming into the country, they're coming in very small quantities. So you used to be able to get these things all day long for like $89, $100, $150. And now you're kind of in the $300 to $350, and I am seeing them on GunBroker even going up over $400, and that's for the Bulgarian ones. Going up over $400, even though they're still coming into the country. So I think that these are on their way out. These are almost, again, through the importers, we're seeing them come in very, very small quantities. So when they eventually dry up, again, these are gonna go up pretty high in value, I suspect. Okay, here's a couple more, and these are rifles, and these are some surplus rifles that have recently pretty much all dried up as far as on the retail market. Have become very, very popular and very highly spoken of, especially around YouTube. I'm giving you guys hints. Another hint is they do come from Switzerland. Okay, I got them here. I only got two of these, and I'm very carefully. When you get these surplus rifles, and they're wrapped up in bubble wrap, you gotta be very, very careful about cutting this stuff off as to not leave big cuts or gouges in the wooden stocks. What I'm taking my time and doing right now. Okay, and what I have here are a couple K31 Swiss rifles. Very, very neat. I'm sure you're all very familiar with these. Very good condition. But anyway, like I said, I just got a couple of these in. I will open up the other one and let you take a look at that one too. And here is the other one in a slightly darker stock, which is really nice. So this has more of a phosphated finish, which was true and did happen on the later K31s. The other one was more blued. This, I believe, is 1953, and the other one, I believe, is the late 40s at some point. But both very, very nice condition, as would be expected on a K31. These are always in very good shape since they were never really used in the war, Switzerland being neutral. But anyway, very cool and happy to get those in. Okay, so we're now into day number two of this vlog. Yesterday, about halfway through the day, I got slammed, and which is really good. And couldn't really film anymore, but I did get some more stuff in. Again, bulking up for what will be our more busy season, the fall and the summer, or fall and the winter, sorry. So getting in a bunch of stuff. So you've seen a lot of surplus stuff now. I've gotten in some of the random new guns that you typically see hanging on walls and inside of display cases in gun stores. So let me get this open and I'll show you what kind of stuff I got in. Okay, so number one, and I think these are incredibly cool and they've gotten very good reviews. I have a customer who bought one of these, actually ordered one in through my store, and I looked at it and kind of thought it was really, really cool. So what this is the little CZ-527, and this is a 7.62 by 39 carbine, and it is bolt action, 5-round magazine, really nice, kind of high-vis, fiber optic sights, and all that sort of thing. I looked at some reviews on these, and actually the reviews online are phenomenal for this, so if you're looking to pick one of these up, I really recommend it. I have not shot one yet, kind of getting this in the store just to feel out interest. If nobody buys it here in the next month or so, it'll probably end up going home with me because I would really like to try it out. And if I can take it out and shoot it, I can make a video about it. So it's kind of a win-win for all of us. So that's really cool. I like this thing a lot. All right, so this next one you guys are probably going to think is pretty cool. Something that's relatively new to the market that I have not had in yet. And that is this Mossberg 590, and you will, 590M, there you go. And you will notice kind of there's a weird opening on the bottom. And that is because it takes this rather interesting, looks like a double column single feed magazine that locks in almost like an AK mag. Gives you a really interesting looking rig there, isn't that fun? Yeah, interesting. Can only imagine when that's, so that's kind of a big weight hanging down there, but that's pretty cool. It's different. I love it when companies innovate like this, but I mean, the magazine fed shotgun's not really an innovation. Kind of new to the pump shotgun scene. I'm sure that there are some that exist, but at least it's cool to see it on the classic 590, right? So very cool. And then all the other stuff I got is just a bunch of Ruger 10/22s, which you've seen one, you've seen them all. Ruger comes out with many different variations of them. You get them in different sizes, and this one came with a scope and a hard case, and again, you've seen one, you've seen them all. So Bulletsponge on YouTube, and if you guys have maybe seen the video we did on the PDW build, the AR-15 maybe, gosh, it's been probably almost a year ago now. He stopped by and wanted to show me this. He actually picked up at a pawn shop. So that goes to show you the really crazy stuff that you could find at pawn shops. But Atlantic Firearms used to sell these. Do you know, do they still sell them, or are they out of, they've been out of stock?
No, they no longer import Russian firearms.
That's, okay, so this is back in the day.
Yeah.
But anyway, he ended up finding this at a great price, and that's just a testament of the cool stuff. You don't know what you'll find kind of hanging around the corner at an old pawn shop. So very, very cool, and just a beautiful firearm. Now, they did a conversion on these. This would have come in without the pistol grip, and the trigger guard would be a little bit further back. So they moved the trigger grip forward, put on the pistol grip, and then there was a company that actually made these for Atlantic, the furniture. So they knew this as the Russian Red, but a beautiful firearm.
All right. Today's show and tell. AR-7. This is actually an original Armalite. I'm pretty sure that the stock design was originally an accident, because the way you get this is when you change colors in plastic molding. I've seen shells like this. Anyway, they float. Originally designed in 58. Adopted by the military, the Air Force, in 59 as a survival, pilot survival rifle. Everything packs into the stock. I don't know how long the cap on these stocks is actually waterproof, but I think they actually float in such a way that the cap's above level. I don't know, because I'm not going to throw mine in the creek to find out. Did find out that when you don't have the barrel in this, you do not want to pull that pin for the bolt out, because if you do, everything in there goes shooting that way, and it's no fun. And yes, I'm talking, so this is taking a little longer than normal, but it's still in a matter of a couple minutes. Yep, 22 semi-automatic rifle.
And they are super lightweight too. I had a Henry made survival rifle in here at one point. They are very light.
I wish I'd have known you had that. I'd have bought
it. Oh, it was a long time ago.
The Air Force adopted these in 1959 to replace the AR-5, which was a single shot survival rifle. Tubular. This actually came out lighter, had semi-automatic capabilities. Downside, does not lock back on an empty magazine. They are good shooters, adjustable peep in the rear, driftable front sight, but if you adjust the rear one right, you don't have to worry about that.
Okay, so day number three of trying to get this vlog filmed. So we've been very, very, very busy in the store, which is great, but I am both sort of in charge of running the vlog and also running the store. So when I get busy, I kind of have to neglect YouTube for a minute, and that's kind of what happened. So sorry for the late content. I have a whole bunch of ideas coming up for future videos as well. But to wrap this up with the question of the week. Now, I get this question very frequently with first-time buyers especially, or people who have owned guns their entire lives, but now they have young kids in the home. And that is how to properly secure or stow your firearms to keep them safe from what we say, keeping honest people honest. You know, if you have friends over, friends of friends over, you just want to keep them secure. Or if you have children in the home, most importantly, that's the number one concern most people have, is young kids getting into the firearms. Or maybe you have other people in the home who you don't want to have ready access to your firearm. Maybe you're still living at home with your parents. You have siblings that you don't want messing around with your stuff. There are some basic options, and there's a funny misconception that a safe firearm is an unusable firearm. And you usually see that sort of like in the comedy, like the stand-up circuit, when people make fun of firearms owners, it's usually the one thing they talk about. It's, you know, oh, you know, people talk about accidental, you know, shootings in the home, and, you know, I'm going to keep my firearm safe, and then, you know, they joke about people breaking into the home at night and the guy having to go over to his combination and say, you know, hold on a second, I need to get my firearm.
Right? So she starts reading up on guns, you know? She's reading too much, because now she wants to get one, but she's just like, well, I heard you got to keep the bullets in the safe, keep the stock in the garage. And then what? Then what? I run around the house and assemble it. There's some dudes chasing me with an axe. You know, even thinking this thing through, sweetheart. Just running around. Where's the scope? It's in the living room. He's in the living room. No, we're getting this thing. I want that thing loaded right on the bedroom wall, right there. I'll put that thing up my jam sleeves. Just like that.
It's not quite like that, and I know that that's comedy, and comedy sort of exaggerates things, but that's sort of the premise of what a lot of people think. There are safe ways to store your firearms that can give you direct and ready access. There are quick deployment safes on the market. I actually just use, and I keep in my nightstand a safe. It's a small, just a clamshell safe, and I have a bicycle cord around it, kind of attached to the frame of my nightstand. It's not going to stop somebody breaking into the home and stealing it. All they need is a simple set of bolt cutters or to break the frame on my nightstand. But what that's really for is I have a young one at home. He's about 3 years old and he's starting to get into things. So during the day, I mean, it's just, it becomes part of your routine. I wake up, I close and just lock the little floor safe, and I just stick the key in my pocket or put it on my keychain. And at night, I mean, and it stays locked the entire day. And then at night, when I'm ready to go to bed, I unlock the clamshell safe and, you know, put the key on the nightstand. And then that way, if somebody breaks in, I can quickly get into the firearm, no problem. The firearm is loaded at all times, except again, when I'm not home, it stays locked up. All my other firearms, every other firearm that I own is actually in a actual standing safe. So I don't have anything sitting out. Now, I did have a whole bunch of ammunition and stuff just sitting out. I won't say just sitting out. I kind of have a side room that's really, really just for me to go into. But my kid goes into it sometimes, and he's not going to do much with ammunition alone without a firearm. But even so, I transferred another safe, actually from my store that we weren't using, home to my garage, and I loaded all the ammunition in there. So it is really important. It is a huge part of a firearm responsibility to keep things secure from young ones or from other people, maybe relatives in the family who might have a criminal record. It is the responsibility of all firearm owners to keep those firearms safe and locked away to mitigate any risk of things happening. But it is also important to make sure that you can get ready access to at least one of your firearms that you're keeping for home protection, which is a reason a lot of people own firearms. But again, when you're not using it, keep it safe. I would like to hear from you guys down in the comment section what your strategies are for keeping firearms locked away at home, where you can get ready access to them while simultaneously keeping them safe away from prying or wandering hands, that sort of thing. So anyway, I will leave you guys with that. So my name is Chris. You are watching Marksman TV. I will see you guys next time.